Hi, Courtney.
You have a very well-rounded career. You've done films like The Cuban and Rememory with Peter Dinklage that was at Sundance.
Yes.
You've done TV shows like Endlings and Odd Squad Mobile Unit and more. You've done documentaries.
Yep.
Many, many, many documentaries. And you are also the vice president of the Canadian Cinema Editors.
That is correct. I am.
You bring a lot of perspectives to the table, I think, as an editor, because you come from it from all these different angles.
Oh, cool. I mean, I never really thought about it that way.
There's so many different ways to become an editor. And I love hearing how different people have gone through that journey.
Yeah, totally. Yeah.
How did you decide to become an editor, and what was your journey to get there?
You know, it's one of those things where I remember deciding that I liked editing, but then I realized that I liked editing long before I knew that I liked editing. The very first editing that I ever did was when I was a kid, and I would tape movies off of TV, hook up two VCRs, and cut out the commercials. And then when I was in high school, I was on the video yearbook, in the video yearbook club, which was basically just like we filmed events and then created this video at the end of the year. And I was one of the editors on the video team, and I sat in this room that we had these two old tape-to-tape like recording things, you know, with the scroll wheel and the like mark in, mark out, preview record thing. And I would cut all of this stuff to music, you know, people playing soccer and running around. And I thought that was really fun. But I didn't think of that for years as being important or as being a job or as being, I knew that I liked the technology, and I considered myself like a bit of a tech geek. And I loved movies, and I always loved watching movies and going to the video store. But I don't know, that the role of an editor never occurred to me even while I was actually editing those things. And it wasn't until much, much later, after I had done an undergrad that wasn't, I did film studies, but not like actual practical filmmaking, and then did some other things in life and then went to film school, that I was finally like, oh, I'm going to do editing. And realized that it was really something that I loved. And so I basically kind of made that decision finally when I was at Sheridan in the advanced film and television program.
The post-grad program.
Yeah, and I went back to school when I was about 26 or 27 and did that post-grad program. And it was the best thing, like the best thing I ever did. It was, it was one of those things where before I did that, I wasn't really sure if I could be in the film industry, because I wasn't before that. I was doing other things, and I'd always wanted to be in film, but I'd never really felt like I'd given it a shot. And then I thought, okay, you know what? I'm going to just try this. And when I finished Sheridan, I was really, really fortunate. I got a job almost immediately as an assistant editor in a reality television company. Mm. It was actually an assistant online editor. So I was basically helping the online editor do conforms and picture finishing and color correction and stuff like that. But that was really great because it gave me a really, really good technical base on which to kind of work. So I did that for a couple of years. Actually, I'm not sure, maybe like 3 or 4 years. I worked in, reality and unscripted, and then sort of wiggled my way into documentary.
But you also went to the Canadian Film Center.
I did. So I did that a little bit later. I worked in documentary for like about 5 years.
Oh, okay.
And was trying to do other things on the side. Like I would try to cut little short films and stuff. But what I found was that pretty much all my contacts were documentary contacts. It was a very, very segmented industry at that time. And documentary people and scripted people did not work together. It was just two completely different networks of people. So I realized that if I really wanted to do scripted work, I had to meet some new people. And I decided that the way to do that was to try going to the Film Center. I think there's lots of different ways to do that transition. I don't want to close any doors too. I mean, that's the other way that I've always approached my career, is that I can never go wrong working with smart, interesting people, regardless of what the thing is. So whether it's a documentary, whether it's like a TV show, whether it's a kids show, whether it's a serious dramatic film, like whatever it is, you know, if I meet the people, if I like them, if I think that we can get along and I like the idea of what they're trying to say with their film or show or whatever, then I'm usually interested in working on it. So that's kind of also taken me at a little bit of a zigzag sometimes to different types of work.
You bring something to the table when you've worked on a documentary or you've worked on reality where you have to cut things together and put it back together and you change the order of the story, where yeah. that doesn't always happen to that extreme in scripted television.
For sure. And I find it helps a lot in features because as you, what you said is sort of right. Scripted television tends to, because it's a bit of a big machine that's already kind of been a proven, usually it's a proven thing, unless you're cutting a pilot or, you know, the first couple of episodes of something. Everybody knows kind of what the show's supposed to be, you know, how long it's supposed to be, you know, kind of what the beats are supposed to be. And as an editor, you have a lot of freedom to make certain decisions, but doing major things like taking the whole thing and turning it around and putting the end at the beginning doesn't tend to happen. In feature films, though, that can happen a lot more often because it is really challenging to find the best way to tell a single story in 2 hours, where you're introducing a character, introducing a world, introducing all the things that you need to know about that person and where they live and what's happening in like 15 minutes. You have to do that basically. And then you have to go through all of the steps that you need to tell their story. It's really challenging. So I find that my documentary experience helped a lot with features because you can really look and break down those types of story arcs with characters and think, you know, you're having a lot of conversations with the director about, okay, are we hitting these story points in the right way? Is the pacing working? Is this scene slowing down the film? Should we move this here? There's a lot of those like big story discussions that happen when you're cutting a feature film. So yeah, my doc experience is always really helpful. Yeah, and it also means that doing documentaries, you often have to think outside of the box because things are not necessarily shot prescriptively. Not every piece of B-roll is shot with something in mind. Like they just shoot with, you know, they're in a place and something's happening and they shoot the thing. And so you have to spend a lot of time thinking about the footage and trying to mine the footage for the moments that you want. And often, although you do want the film to kind of come out of the footage, often you're doing a lot more where you're imposing a story or a pacing or whatever onto the footage, right? You're not just necessarily taking what the footage is giving you. You're saying, okay, here's what I want the feel to be of this, or the rhythm or the pacing. How can I make that out of this? You have to kind of spend a little bit more time trying to be creative with the material. And when you're dealing with scripted stuff, that's actually also a really good thing to do anytime, is like, don't just take what you're given. Take it, look at it, consider it, and then say, okay, this is great, but what do I wish for? What do I wish they shot? Which we always say as editors, oh, I wish they got this one thing, you know? And sometimes they didn't get it and there's nothing you can do, but a lot of times you can say, okay, why am I wishing for this shot? Or why am I wishing for this moment that's missing? Mm-hmm. Okay, how can we find a substitute for this? How can we make something else do the job that we needed this shot to do, or that we needed this moment to do? And often there's creative ways to make it work.
That's the best part, actually.
It's the most exciting when you find something like that, right? Yeah. And when you're agonizing over it and you're like feeling like, oh man, this is never gonna work, you know? And then suddenly the light just goes on. You're like, oh, what if we do this? And sometimes it's as simple as removing a couple of lines from something, and then suddenly a character is perceived in a different way, or what the character's trying to do is perceived slightly differently, and suddenly things fall into place. Sometimes it's a matter of moving something. Sometimes it's a matter of trying to talk the director into doing pickup shoots, which happens too. But again, that's also like from a documentary side, like as an editor on a few of the features that I've done, there has been some kind of room for pickups, even if they're just tiny pickups. That kind of stuff is really fun for me as an editor.
I wanted to ask you how you handle the logistics of being a freelancer.
And there's a few different considerations that you have to think about as a freelancer. And some of them are obvious and some of them are not. So the obvious one is that you don't have a consistent income stream. Right? The obvious one is you make money when you're working, and when you're not working, you don't make money. And so you have to kind of put systems in place for yourself that allow you to save money to use during the dry periods when you're not working. I think the difficult part of being a freelancer for me always was the more like emotional side of being a freelancer, which is the sort of the anxiety that you feel when you're not working or when you're coming to the end of a job and you don't have something lined up, and sort of navigating those like ups and downs. And for me, it goes this way. I get a job. I'm super excited to have the job. I'm like I like imagining how great this job is going to be. I start the job. I'm super excited. Then like I start assembling the project, and then I create the assembly of whatever it is. And I hate it. And I hate the assembly, and I'm just like, man, this didn't turn out at all like I thought. This is terrible. This is the worst thing ever. So then it goes uphill from there. And then like, I feel better and I work with the director and we get along and it's all good. And then we create a final film and then I'm really excited and I love the film and it's awesome. And hopefully other people like it too. But even if they don't, that's okay. I usually really like it and I feel good about it at the end. And then I have no job. I have to start looking for another job. And then I do interviews and I don't get the jobs that I want to get. And then I'm, you know, and so it's this, and it's like that multiple times a year, every year, at least for me, it hasn't changed. Like I sort of thought, I think when I was younger, I thought that that would go away, that once I became more experienced, that I wouldn't have that roller coaster, but I still have it. And I think from talking to most people that I know, most creative people in the film industry, they also have it their whole lives. Because when you're a creative person and you're working on something that you're working on things that you care about, your sense of like self and value can easily get like very bound up in what you're working on. And if it goes well, you feel great about yourself. And if it's not going well or something's going badly, it can really affect your self-esteem. It can affect your energy levels. It can affect like a lot of things. And those are kind of the psychological aspects of being a freelancer that I think people don't necessarily talk about. They've been talking about a little bit more now because there's been a lot more conversations around mental health and stuff because of COVID. That's certainly something that when I was starting out as a freelancer, nobody ever told me. Like they all told me that I needed to manage my money and they all told me that I needed to, you know, make sure I saved up or whatever. But nobody said, oh, your life is going to be an emotional roller coaster for the rest of your life, you know? So I think that to me is the biggest thing was trying to understand that about myself, but also understand that it was really common, like that it wasn't just me, like that everybody else, or a lot of other people have that in their lives, and that it's okay, and that you can learn how to manage that depending on your personality and things that you like to do. You know, I found when I was first starting out that it was really, really hard to cultivate my hobbies because you're networking and you're going to events and you're working on three different projects at once because you have a day job as an assistant editor, but then you're also trying to cut people's projects at night, and everything that you're doing is about getting ahead in your chosen career. Mm-hmm. And it's great to be enthusiastic, but one of the best things that I started doing after a couple of years of that was I just started going back to some of the hobbies that I had had before that I had sort of put aside because I was doing film and I was obsessed with film. So that's the other thing that I would encourage people to do, particularly young people, is to remember those other things and to make time for those other things, whatever they are, whether it's, you know, doing something outdoor activity or whether it's studying a language that they like, or just even like playing board games or whatever, like whatever the thing is, keep doing the thing and hopefully also spending time with other people that are doing the thing that maybe aren't the same people that you're networking with or that are in your filmmaking community. Because if your entire life is only other people who are in the film industry, you'll find yourself going insane because you just, that'll be all you ever talk about.
Yeah.
And that'll be all you ever think about when you're with your friends, and you'll, even if you don't want to be, you'll be comparing yourself to those people in terms of what kind of projects that you're doing and how well you're doing or not doing. And if all of your friends are working and you're not working and you're all in the film business, then you'll feel bad. Try to keep some people that ground you outside of it so that you don't get completely swept up in that. And it's really hard when you're starting out because you just want to put all of your energy into, and you should put as much energy as you can into doing what you love. but just be aware of how much energy you actually have. And it's different for everybody. Taking time and learning to know yourself, know your habits, know your interests, know how you like to work and how you don't like to work. Are you a morning person? Are you not a morning person? Like, everybody's different, but learn what works for you. When do you do your best work as an editor? Do you do it first thing in the morning when you sit down, or do you do it at 11 o'clock at night? Figure it out and try to make your life work for that. It's really challenging as a freelancer to do that because people are always putting demands on your time. As a freelancer, I'm often juggling a couple of projects at once, maybe like a big project and then like some short film that I started 2 months ago and haven't finished and I'm trying to do on the weekends. And, you know, and people are emailing you at weird times, and you have to kind of be very conscious of the fact that your time is still your own, mm-hmm. even though you're a freelancer. It's up to you how you want to use your time in any given day.
But how do you put those limits?
Well, there's like practical ways to put the limits, and then there's like more philosophical ways to put the limits. I find that actually the practical ways help philosophically because, you know, I'm the type of person where if I get an email and I have to, and I read it and I know what the person wants, I have a really hard time not dealing with it right then. Yeah. I'm like, oh, they want to do, okay, I should just go do this. And if I don't do it, then I'm stewing and I keep thinking about how they sent me that email and I need to do the thing. So... But that's not good. Like, if I get an email at dinner time, I don't want to be like sitting through my dinner, like just try to eat really fast so I can answer some email. So I put a bunch of stuff in place for myself where mm-hmm. I'm very careful about like the alerts on my phone. And I set times where I can pause my inbox. There's like functions where with Gmail where you can pause your inbox at certain hours. You can automate things to be on or off. I do that a lot. So that's like my way of like creating a little barrier for myself first, so that I don't even know the email's there until I know it's going to be a good time for me to find out.
That's a really good tip.
And the other thing too is I also try to manage other people's expectations by not always giving them what they want exactly when they want it.
Like with a deadline?
No, a deadline is a deadline. But okay. If somebody emails me, I don't necessarily jump and reply right away.
Okay.
Because I don't want them to think that that is always going to happen. And I that particularly applies to when I first start working with someone. Like if it's somebody that I know well or I've worked with a bunch of times, it's not whatever. But if I've started on a new project and I'm getting peppered with emails from two different producers, you know, in the first week, I have to balance my obviously desire to like work well and do my job and get back to them without setting a precedent that that's going to be the vibe, you know? I also like schedule emails all the time. If somebody emails me at 9 o'clock at night, they don't usually get an answer that night. They'll get an answer in the morning, but I might do the answer. Like I might still be at my desk. I might still be working. Mm-hmm. They don't know that. I get the email. I deal with all the things, answer the email, and then I schedule it to go out at 9 in the morning. Mm-hmm. So for me, I know that it's done. I know that I've done the thing. But for them, they see me working during the hours that during my work hours, which are like, you know, between 8:30 and 5:30 or 6, whatever they happen to be. I think about that sort of thing a lot. I've recognized that just because a producer thinks that something should be done in a certain period of time doesn't mean that that's true.
Yeah.
And they don't necessarily know best. They know what they want to have happen, mm-hmm. but it's your job to, you know, do what's possible to have happen as an editor. And I think often, particularly in unscripted and doc, but I think this is true, can be true in scripted as well, is that everybody underestimates how long something's going to take to edit. And they underestimate the amount of work that you have to do that's not even creative work. They underestimate the amount of time it's going to take you to like ingest the footage, or if you're doing something small by yourself and you don't have an assistant, like sync the footage and get your whole project organized, mm-hmm. and then go through all the footage and watch it and think about it and make decisions about it and then edit the thing. Like people don't think about that sort of thing. So one of the things that I try to do whenever I take on a new project is I ask the producers a bunch of questions. They might say like, oh, we want to have something by next week. And I'll be like, okay, let me ask you all these questions. And I ask all the questions. And then I say, okay, I'll go away and I'm going to write out a little editing schedule. And then I'll get back to you and then we can talk about it. But so then I go away and I spend time and I think about it. And I look at my calendar and I make it a little document and I make a schedule. and then I present it back to them. And usually I've never had somebody see a schedule that I've made and say, no, you're allowing too much time. Because once they see it broken down of like, okay, like 2 days to ingest the stuff and, a, you know, 2 days to sync and then viewing for, like I break it down, like all the different steps that I'm going to take, when the rough cut's going to go, when's the fine cut's going to go. And then when they see that, they're like, oh, right, it's going to be in 2 weeks that we have, you know, a fine cut. And I'm like, yeah, that's probably what it's going to be. And they're like, okay. Like they're always, I've never had a problem with that. So that takes a little bit of time.
And experience.
And experience. But you can also, like, if you're in a position, you know, I say this to younger people, like if you're in a position where you need to prepare something like that, where, or like somebody's asked you to do a job and you're not sure if you can do it in the amount of time that they want you to do, or you feel like something's a bit weird about it, ask somebody else, ask another editor. If you're not confident in your ability to make those determinations, then get some advice from somebody that knows and think about that before you take on a job and make sure that everyone that you're working for, all of their expectations are in line. Because that's the one thing that causes relationships to go completely wonky is mismatched expectations. That's what it is, right? In any, like in anything in life, really. That's what it is.
This isn't about editing anymore. This is life. These are life skills.
If you can get other people on board, everyone will be happy. And everyone will think they had a great experience. And they'll hire you again, or they'll recommend you to somebody else, right? But if there's just a miscommunication about timelines, or there's frustration, or somebody didn't understand that they were supposed to, they thought they weren't responsible for something, but it turns out they are responsible for something. That's how things can just very easily kind of go off the rails and break, right? So that's something that I'm very conscious of, is managing everybody's expectations.
Jane, I love everything that you said. These are such important things to think about. Have a hobby. Keep your hobbies, I should say. Keep your hobbies. Manage expectations. I also love the alerts on sending emails and shutting down your email.
There's so many great tools and there's more every day for those types of things. And they're, it's great.
So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. Can I plug my YouTube channel?
Yes.
I have a YouTube channel where I post tutorials about workflow. So it's my company name. It's Fast Hat Films. So maybe you can link it in the description of this video. And
absolutely.
And I do like video tutorials. I have like a 9 or 10 part series on like doing dailies in Resolve and syncing audio in Avid and like doing all that kind of assistant-y stuff that, I don't know, people who are graduating like might find handy. So they should check it out.
I'm going to check it out too.
Well, thank you. It was really fun to talk to you.